Friday evening, we want to, we don't come in. But anyway, things that we probably need to know for sure, and I would like to see many of you learn these pictures by memory. First of all, we've been studying about the Ministry of Reconciliation, and that is the primary purpose of believers. Primary, the reason why we are called into fellowship, so that we can actually be a part of the Ministry of Reconciliation. And scriptures like this, you will automatically probably learn at some point. New members, we're going to take it real slow with them, as we want them to be really involved in bringing the friends and their loved ones. The purpose of a believer, okay, what would y'all say if you had to give about three or four reasons why you are a believer and the purpose that the scripture says that we've been called to do? The purpose. What is our purpose? Okay, I'd like for y'all to just give some input on that.
Glorify God.
Okay. Anybody can remember scripture which talks about to glorify God? And how do we glorify God? Gentleness or self-control.
Patience.
Okay. Now, patience. These are not the fruit that you see initially manifested in the life. Okay. Which ones do you see first? You see what? Love, joy, and peace. Isn't that something? Those are the ones that you should help people to get established. Love, joy, and what?
Peace.
You really want to see some love, just get around somebody that just got saved, right? You get excited, and somebody that's happy, if they really understand what they have received.
The peace, I think, comes with that, too. Because once you understand, then it's like a burden is lifted off.
And that's really the first thing. These are the first things that we see manifested in the believer. And because those are the ones that normally helps us to get what? Established. Okay, then the one, kindness, goodness, patience, good, what else? Patience, kindness, and goodness. How do you think they are developed? Are they developed instantly?
Some are still working on it.
Yeah, I agree with that. Some are still working on it.
Well, how do they get born?
But now, some kindness, I want to say something about kindness and goodness. Sometimes people that are not saved are just kind and they're just good. You know, they're not received. That's their nature. They have not received the Holy Spirit. They just basically are good people. That's right, good people. But now patience, we have to kind of develop.
Amen.
Work on that a little bit. Yes.
Okay, what do you have to do to get patience and these other ones which characterize a person that's been established in the Word? In other words, people that are growing in grace, or people that are developing in righteousness. What do you think can really facilitate that process before, you know, where those things will really begin to manifest?
I think that's one of the reasons why we keep saying that those are things that take time, because patience, usually you have to see a result to realize that your patience and endurance has accomplished something. And same with faithfulness. Uses faith is based on substance, hope for it if it's things not seen, faith. But when you see God manifest in your life, then it grows.
Okay.
You were asking, I think 2 Peter, 1st chapter, beginning at the 3rd verse, down to the 10th verse, tell us how to develop these things. It outlines it real well.
Okay, read that.
Okay.
The 2 Peter.
2 Peter, 1st chapter, beginning at the 3rd verse. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sin. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall.
Okay. So just break it down. All of that can be broken down, I guess.
Okay. Well, one of the first things you have to do is we got to be saved first. And it says these things come through the knowledge of him. You've got to have the knowledge of him and understand his precious promises. And then skipping down to verse 5, it says, and besides this, in other words, there's something else you have to do when it says besides this. Then giving all diligence, that's where we come in. The first part is, you know, God has done something for us. And then this is our part here. We have to give diligence to add these things and keep adding them. verse 8, if these things be in you and abound, then they should make you to be neither unbearing or unfruitful. So if these things are in us, then that's how, that's one way we can be very fruitful. Actually, to ourselves first, we have to be possessors of it first, and then we're able, once we have it, then we're able to, you know, to share. And if we don't have this, if we haven't worked on these areas ourselves, then we're not as willing to share with others because we don't feel that confident doing it.
Okay, if there were a new person that didn't understand the process that we just went over, what would you tell them if you really wanted, if they really wanted to see some growth in grace in terms of character? Because many times when people first come into the church, they're struggling, and many times they have not developed a habit of coming to church. And so it's kind of like a challenge, because many times new people might not really understand the Bible like people that's been hearing it for a while. And then many times their background hasn't lent itself to for them to just jump right into being in regular attendance at church. And most times they will opt more or less just to come on Sunday. So what do y'all have to say about, because we're trying to get people established in the Word, and there's some things, basic things that all of us had to do in order to get established to the point where you like, you know, to come to church. You know, everybody's not going to like coming to church. And they'll just come on Sunday, and they'll come more or less because people are like admonishing them to come. So what can you say to new members when they coming into the fold? Many times they're hanging on by the skin of their teeth, and really what we're doing and what we're talking about might not be that exciting for them.
Well, I think that's where we come in. We have to create some excitement. And here again, going back to verse 8, mm-hmm. no, 5. And besides this, and I don't know if there is a reason that is in this order that is listed. Mm-hmm. It, the first one is giving all diligence. Mm-hmm. That's the first one. And if a person is not accustomed to being diligent, maybe you can help to draw some kind of parallel in a practical sense. Mm-hmm. Like some people that worked on the job 20 years and they never missed a day, you know. But that's, to me, an exception rather than the rule. But you, if you're diligent in your employment and what do you call the things of the world, then maybe you can draw on a parallel to them in terms of how they can be diligent in the things of God. You mentioned coming to church. And explain to them why it's necessary, not just coming to church just to be coming, but what it will do for them, because what benefits they would receive. Because most people want to know, well, whatever you tell them or whatever you're asking for, what is it going to do for me? What kind of benefit is it for me? So I think if you can explain the benefits, this is the reason why this needs to be done, a person can receive it better rather than just you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do that. Explain the reasons why.
Okay.
And how it would benefit them,
okay.
Not
right.
necessarily me,
all
the
right.
person that's sharing, but how it's going to benefit them.
Okay, let's explain. Somebody has been explaining.
One way to explain it to people is, Bill said that we can use practical examples. We could say, like, you eat every day, but then your body goes from by the natural food that you eat. When you come to church and you hear the pastor speaker, you hear different people speak, that feeds your spirit, and therefore your spirit is even stronger. you need your spirit to be strong to live an overcoming life. And you explain what that overcoming life is, what the overcoming life would do, and you would just explain the more food that they would get, spiritual food that they would get, the stronger their spirits would become. And another thing, besides from the church and hearing the pastor, they could try and listen to maybe music on the radio or the on their DVD. CD, and they could read their Bibles at home because that will strengthen them also.
And then, Pastor, you can also say, you know, I haven't always been where I am now. There was a time when this was a struggle for me. I can relate to what you're going through, but I had to be persistent. I had no choice within my own mind, my own self. In order for me to grow, this is what I knew I had to do. And so for me, it was almost a life and death. In order for me to live, in order for me to grow, in order for me to mature, I had to do this. And so maybe you can relate to that, to their struggle.
Okay. Now suppose challenge would be for many of them, many people that just started out is that like coming on Wednesday night might be something that they understand. What we're talking about when we're starting out, don't get as much out of it as we can get. And maybe that motivation would be a lot lower.
So that's individual help would come in.
What good would it do to come and, you know, really understand a lot of the concepts and principles that's going to talk to them?
Maybe somebody needs to assist.
Right,
because if somebody did call him on a regular basis, they could explain what the pastor with them, and then they could explain it piece by piece, or maybe that person would have a question and they could answer that question, and that would help them.
Okay. All right. When we say explain it piece by piece, I know I'm quick, but I don't know what I'm talking about.
Thanks, sir.
Okay. Now, suppose I'm just trying to get y'all in a position really to begin to help people. All right, suppose, does a new member or a convert have to understand everything that's going on in the session?
No, absolutely not.
That's why you keep coming to learn. Right. We don't all understand everything. We're still evolving and learning.
Okay, so usually in every session, whether they understand the whole context of what we've presented, they will be able to, God will quicken some things that's going to be said, right? And they will be able to what? Get something out of it. Every session that God quickens, you know, God, you know, he knows how to go about giving us what we need, or making manifest the things that he really wants us to, you know, be partakers of. All right, now what other benefit? Now, I know a new member might be sitting in on Wednesday night. Now, what can we do to get more new members? Because most times new members are going to be of the persuasion that I'll come on Sunday. And they're not going to see that much relevance into Wednesday night. You can see that tonight. I have on my list here, I have probably about 25 people.
That have what? 25 people?
That just came recently that we see on Sunday. A lot of them that we see. Well, of course, we saw quite a few last week. New ones, but we have quite a few people here on here that somebody invited. I can read them off, but I'm not. 1, 2, 3, 4, five, six, seven, eight.
So your point is?
Nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26. Okay, so what can we do in order to get those that show up on Sunday interested, or even get over to them the importance of coming Wednesday night, although they might be new at this? What can we do?
Same thing we just said.
The same thing you just said? All right. Okay, how can we approach it? How can we approach it? I mean, okay, well, this is like, all right, now, Sister Hill and Sister Dorothy, maybe they're the three that will be responsible for all of this. But I was thinking that, everybody that normally should have been invited by a member that's interested in their song. Now, I was thinking that if Sister Marianne is here tonight, it's going to be a little job for everybody. All of us going to have a part to play in this, but Sister Marianne probably would be in a better position to persuade that. I know that she invited your hand. Sunday she was sitting with them and, giving them some support. I like that. And last week, I called one of her prospects, and as I was calling, Marianne was walking in the house. And Sunday they were there by her side. So I think that...
So what you're saying is follow-up.
Follow-up. Like we're trying to get some kind of system drawn up where we can know for sure that the right type of follow-up is actually instituted. So I think that just like the two here tonight, Sister Tanya just walked in, to one, all right? Yeah, she was already here. But Sister Judy, I think, has she called you this week? She hasn't called? Yeah, Sister Tanya?
Oh, no.
She hasn't called? Okay. Who was she? Okay. All right, but she always asks, did they show up? Okay, so Sharita. Now, Friday evening, I think the best ones to persuade them to come probably Friday evening, because we really want to get a breakthrough with all of the new members, well, not new members, those that's been coming to visit us. We want to get a breakthrough. In other words, we want to get them saved, and we want them to know for sure that they're saved. We want them to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We want to teach them how to completely surrender to the Lord so the Lord can really break the dominion of sin and really give them the assurance that they have a real new relationship with Him. And then we want to fill with the Holy Spirit. Usually if you can get people filled with the Holy Spirit, and I think that I have tried both ways. Sometimes you study with people until you get all the information over 5 or 6 weeks, and then start working towards them getting the Holy Spirit. But I think that it might be better to try to get them filled with the Holy Spirit right away, so that they would be a lot more spiritually receptive, and then they will experience a breakthrough and the powers of, if a person receives the Holy Spirit, the power of darkness is definitely has to be broken. And that's one way you can know that they are delivered, they are free. If they, not just them accepting Christ, sometimes it can be something that they do mentally and not really get a full release to the extent where they make a complete commitment to God. But when they receive the Holy Spirit, more than likely, they will experience a real breakthrough. And then their revelation knowledge begins to kick in. They begin to get a, you know, when we talk about things like you're talking about tonight, God will quicken that, and they will, might not know perfectly what we're saying, but God will give them a better revelation, a better understanding of it. So what we're going to try, what we are planning on doing, trying to get as many of them possibly here and do a session. And we feel that the best one to help get them here would be the ones that initially invited them. Y'all agree with that? I could call them and they would have promised me, oh yeah, I'll be there for them, oh yeah. But if you call them, it would be different. Amen. Especially if you help develop a relationship with them. So what we want to do is we want to try to get as many of these people on the list here, and we want to see a real breakthrough among them so that they will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that they're saved and the powers of Satan over their lives have really been broken. That requires prayer. That requires a little teaching where they will understand the importance of yielding. Once they hear the word and know the gospel and know what God really wants to do for them, then we have to teach them how to yield and let go and let God. There's got to be some degree of brokenness. And so that's what we're going to be shooting for. Now, the advantage of Saints attending sessions like that would be that you would get a chance to meet different ones, and rather than Sister Mary Ann being called two or three times a day, then she could well say, well, did you meet Sister Dorothy? Oh, did you meet Sister Pearl? Well, I think that you can just call her. She's real nice. She really would be glad to talk with you. She's good at explaining this or that. So I think that at some point, we're going to have to connect with new people and get to know them better and then begin to explain to them and let them know that we're really concerned, we love them, and if there's anything that we can do, exchange phone numbers and get to know them. Usually the ones that build a relationship are the ones that they're going to really begin to cater to. They will have a lot of influence over them. And it will be easier to get people to show up on Wednesday night even if that type of relationship is developed. Okay, everybody agree with that? Okay, so Brother Travis said that she would definitely be here. Her job is kind of at an awkward time, but she said she definitely could make it Friday even at 4:30. Okay, so that's a person. She's very open, and she is hungry for the word. And she's a young lady, and I think that it would be very good for her to hook up with somebody that would be really interested in working with, you know, a young lady that's just coming into the kingdom. Okay, so there will be plenty of opportunities for a lot of us to do a lot of things with the new people. It's not like I have to do it all, or Brother Travis has to do it all, Sister Denise has to do it all. But we can establish contact with quite a few people. I just like to call them and just, you know, try to get to know them and try to see, you know, what I can do to inspire them. Okay, now what are some of the things that young converts or young people that are seeking God, what are some things that you feel that would really help them? Now we mentioned coming to church, we'll have even though on Wednesday night, they might not grasp all of the things that we are talking about, but there is a spiritual impartation that takes place whether a person really understands everything that's being conveyed. Something happens spiritually that draws you closer, that gives you a little bit more delight or joy or motivation. And how important it is, how important is it to be in fellowship with the saints? Maybe I can put it that way. We mentioned how important the Bible studies are, but how important is it being in fellowship with saints?
Very important.
Yeah. Okay, some of y'all can kind of draw on y'all's past experiences. Okay, how important, somebody can just speak out.
I think it's very important if you develop relationships. You may not develop relationships with everybody, mm-hmm. but you, once you start developing relationships, sometimes you just need encouragement, or they may need encouragement. And if you didn't develop relationships and know them through the church, you wouldn't have that, mm-hmm. that Christian mm-hmm. understanding of, you know, because sometimes you can get information from anybody, mm-hmm. but you want the right information from people that are godly and trying to live by the word of God, and which encourage you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. When you say encourage, what does that mean in a setting like this? How do you encourage somebody?
I mean, even from just natural laws, financial hardships. I mean, all of us have been through something, and sometimes you just need somebody that's been there or at least touched that area of life that can tell you God can help you through it and how He helped you. Exactly. Sometimes it's just telling your testimony.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's just nice to have someone that's glad to see you.
That's true.
You know, that's the truth.
Glad to see
you. The world is cold.
Yeah, it is.
The world is cold.
And sometimes it's glad, it's just good to have somebody to listen to you. Mm-hmm. Yes. A lot of times we think that if a person brings a situation to you, a problem, oh, I got to solve it, I got to solve it. And all the time, that's not what they're looking for. There are so few people that really listen to people. You know, you talk at each other, but not really listening. If you have somebody to really listen to you, and you feel like really understanding, that can make a difference. Mm-hmm. Case in point, mm-hmm. the recent election, Obama received because a lot of people felt like he could relate to them as opposed to the rich man. You know, so we see what happened. That was not the only thing, but
he's a rich man, isn't he?
Yeah, but he's not like that.
He destroyed our rich stuff.
No, so he sure did.
That's another thing. He know what they're every day.
He's been on welfare. He's only been on welfare. But in other words, my point was, if you feel like somebody, you feel like a person understand what you're saying, you may not have a solution to their problem. But if you can empathize with them, a lot of times there's just like, they can exhale, you know, like, that person understands where I am. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times they can solve their own problem, mm-hmm. but they just need to have someone to listen to them mm-hmm. with an attentive ear mm-hmm. and a heart to fit right, that you understand what they're going through.
Actually, mm-hmm. I think Sister Marianne is a wonderful case in point because mm-hmm. that's not an accident that they're calling her every day. I mean, it might be maybe a little worse, and I don't know, but I'm just saying that's not an accident that they're calling her every day. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. All these people in this world, all these lonely people,
right?
Somebody to talk to, somebody to see them, somebody to hear them. You're going to work, you're going here, but nobody's noticing, nobody's paying you any attention. Nobody's seeing that you're hurt. Nobody's seeing. And then finally you meet somebody and they give you a word from God. And and it's like, okay, thank you, God. I can latch on now.
And apparently they feel very comfortable.
That's exactly.
With her.
Yeah.
Very comfortable. Yeah. Otherwise they wouldn't be calling.
They wouldn't be calling. That's right. That's right. Mm-hmm. And she apparently stops mm-hmm. and talks.
Sean Martin texted me today just to tell me she was bored. Okay.
Bible says a strong bird in terms of the wood. How many strongs are there? We need to find another strong person.
And Pastor, if sometimes when the people are asking you questions, you might not know what the answer is, but that's going to make you go to the Bible and study whatever it is that they were talking about, or it will have them call you to find out what the answer is.
Okay.
So that will make you study more because you know they're going to come with more questions. Mm-hmm. So that helps you to get in the Bible more.
Okay. All right, that's good. I'm going to ask Sherita. She's about the newest one that I've seen in a while. One that's been around a little longer to be able to kind of share with somebody else things that meant a lot to her when she first started, you know, coming to church. I want to ask you that. Just think about it for a minute. Can we expect, should we expect our people that just start coming to read their Bible?
Should we expect them to? We can tell them.
Yeah.
Well, some people, that's been coming for years, Doc. But I don't mean that facetiously, but you know, if a person is a reader, some people just are natural readers.
Yeah.
They just like to read. Then it would be easier for them to begin. That just never like to read. That doesn't mean that they're not smart or anything.
No,
just don't like to read. They can absorb it other ways, you know. Listen to it on tape, DVD or whatever, CD. And there's other ways you can get it other than reading if you're a non-reader. So
okay, that's good. I was asked a question in a session. I can't remember exactly what it was. And the new person was saying that I need another type of Bible. I need a Bible that kind of breaks it down a little bit more because I don't understand all of it.
King James.
Okay, now what kind of Bible do y'all use? I mean, anybody
that
uses
one of your Bibles that you had us read.
Okay, what kind of Bible is that?
The one-year Bible where you read the Bible for one year that you had all of us reading would be good for a new member. That's good. That's pretty
good.
It breaks
one
down.
One-year Bible. Okay, hi. Who's that back? Which one?
The one-year Bible.
Okay, the one-year Bible. Anybody remember who that Bible is?
I got it in the car. You want me to get it?
Yeah, get it so we can understand. Get it.
I'll tell you another good one that I like. It's a life application Bible. And what that one is, it has the scriptures in it, but it has it in, it explains it in today's vernacular where you can really understand it. It doesn't, to me, destroy the meaning of the King James or the other versions, but it just kind of amplifies it. It's a life application.
Okay, from right here. The New King James is used as everyday language.
Oh, that's
scriptures. Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Makes it much easier to understand.
Okay, the New King James is an option, and Marianne is going to get the 1 year Bible. Okay, now, what portion of the Bible do y'all suggest people, new members, start out reading?
Okay.
I heard First John and Saint John. Okay. Probably. Which one y'all like?
I like Genesis. Let's start from here. Let's find out why this is going on. That's how I said you. Let's go to like the start. Let's get down to the nitty gritty. This is how this all
goes.
But now, but you said new members.
Yeah, new members. We start with Genesis, it take them 6 months to get to what Jesus is talking about.
But they're different.
Unless it's kind of it's a 1 year thing.
That's right.
You have a little of the Old Testament and a little of the New Testament.
Yeah.
Okay. And so I'm just trying to lay the foundation because we all going to have to be in a position to where we're going to have to advise. Okay, but right here is the way it looks. It's by the New Living Translation.
That's the one we all got.
One Year Bible. New Living Translation. It's a real easy Bible to read. This is a one-year Bible. If you wanted to begin with the Old Testament, a chapter, how does that work, a chapter or two a day?
Well, you got one old, one new,
one
Proverbs, and Psalms. Now, I have a different one in this Bible. This is our, you have the old and the new, and it sets it up differently for each month.
Okay, now, you might find somebody that's interested in reading the Bible through, but the New Testament probably would be something that you would recommend to everybody. And if you wanted to know which of the Gospels probably would be the most important for you personally, I would probably suggest of St. John. St. John and 1 John are really critical. St. John and 1 John. What about Psalms? Y'all like, y'all think that new people should read?
Absolutely. And the
Proverbs? Well, okay. Another tool I use pretty frequently is there's several Bible translators online. Mm-hmm. And if I'm having problems understanding a particular passage, mm-hmm. I can go to that text and read it in several different forms.
Yes, sir.
And if there's a passage that I recall from the lessons, but I don't know where it's at, most of those have a built-in strong exhaustive importance.
Oh, yeah.
I think you can go to the passage immediately. So if a person didn't want to invest in several different Bibles, mm-hmm. they could read it in James.
Okay, let's keep it simple for a new person. What should we tell them? That maybe the Gospels, is that right?
That's what Sister Janine said, the Gospels.
And the specific gospel probably that would mean a whole lot would be the book of St. John, because the book of St. John tells how the same works that Jesus did, the same life that he lived, he's expecting us to what? To live that same life through his what? Through the ability that he's going to what give us. And I think that that's highly recommended, the book of St. John. And it takes them 30 days or 2 months to read it. I think it would be great. But you can always feel free to read, the book of Psalms. Any Psalms, the book of Psalms would be good, right? Proverbs would also be good. And this translation that we call the one-year Bible, the New Translation, the New Living Translations, would be broken down where everybody will be able to understand. You do St. John, you would really be able to understand. It would be really something. You do Book of Psalms, Psalms 1, Psalms 15, that would be what very understood. Proverbs, okay. The personal Bible readings is very, very important because there's a lot that people that just coming into the kingdom, they have to overcome. And that is called the process of what they're doing their mind. They're accustomed to a certain type of what, lifestyle? That lifestyle that they are accustomed to has to be, we have to override that with the word so that it would become more attractive and attractive or more interesting or more captivating than the things that they did for pleasure before they met Christ. I would understand that it's a totally different ballgame. You have to be able to relate to people because they're not going to just automatically want to give up all of those pleasures and fun and relationships.
Well, now that brings up another question. I think Sister Sharita will touch on it. She said you're gonna give her time to talk, think about something. And that is when, especially when young people, maybe some older people, come into, you know, the knowledge of Christ, have challenges. I think there should be a two-pronged approach to it. You deal with the spiritual, and they still have, you know, those natural things they're dealing with. I heard her say that this person wanted to go somewhere that she didn't want to go. Mm-hmm. You know, okay, I'm not really sure what she meant, but I, you know, kind of have an idea. So obviously there's something that that person that needs to be addressed mm-hmm. with that person on a maybe physical level, mm-hmm. you know. And a lot, often we don't do that in ministry and churches. You deal strictly with the spiritual, and people seem to get it. But then the reason why I get it from a mental standpoint, the reason why you know that they don't really get it by what they continue to do. Mm-hmm. So I think that there has to be an integration in terms of, okay, here's what you're dealing with, honey. Okay, here's how you gonna help you with this, and then the spiritual as well to mesh those. Mm-hmm. And I think often that's sad and lacking.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, Sister Sharita, you probably can kind of help us in this area because you have gone through some of these challenges. Mm-hmm. And Brother Travis probably could help us because when he first got saved, he was living with his girlfriend. What do you do? And people going to be in those, I guarantee you, if you went down this list here, I guarantee you, you're going to have these challenges existing all over.
Well, that's the reality of it. Yeah. So, you know, you want to bring people into the ministry and Bible study and all that, but they still have these kind of situations.
Yeah, right, they still got these situations.
Yeah.
And so we got to kind of direct people in a way where they can really begin to get free mm-hmm. so they can really enjoy the proper fellowship, you know, with the Lord. You don't feel good when you know that you are living in a situation where that God is not pleased with it. You really want to have a heart void of all offense. Okay, Sister Sharita, give us a little rundown.
Well, when I first started coming here, I was in a place where everything was worldly. I am totally different from where I was at when I first started coming here. And if Sister Denise and Sister Pearl wouldn't have stayed on me like they did and continued to call me, that's what I'm most appreciative about. Sister Denise and Sister Pearl, they would call and check on me, and Sister Pearl did Bible study with me over the phone, and she wouldn't stop calling me until we did. So, I mean, that's what I'm most appreciative about, and I've learned a lot from them. When I first came here, I was in a relationship, and when I started to continue to come, he didn't understand that. And when I would invite him to come or want him to be involved in what I'm involved, he didn't understand that. And when I did cut my ties, that's when everything really went crazy. The young man I run with me a couple Sundays ago is a friend of mine, and I met him at a time where I was just in a different place in my life. And he's still kind of in that same place, but he says he wants to kind of get back into the work and be more involved. But you can't do that if you still live in the same way, are still doing the same things. And to me, that's not helping me and fulfilling what I want to do as far as being one with the Lord. And I cannot do that and fall with somebody that isn't trying to do that. So as far as him wanting to go, he wanted a relationship with me that I'm not ready for. I'm still trying to develop my relationship with God. And that's my first priority, And that's what I want to do first before I develop a relationship with a man. Because I want to understand him and know him to better understand what kind of man I want or deserve if I did. So that's why I try to help him and I do call and check on him, but he still talks the same way. So I'll call and check on him and invite him to church or whatever, but when he says yes, I'll make sure I bring him. it's like I gotta have a relationship with him in order to get him to go to church, and that isn't the way it should be, you know. So
see if you get up there Friday.
Yeah, and I'll definitely try that, but I'm most appreciative of this church because of the knowledge that it has given me. And I've learned so much in this time that I've been here. And that's what I enjoy most, and that's what keeps coming back for more. Because I do want to know. I do want to learn. And I try to take that little 30 minutes of time and try to read a script or two out of my Bible. Because usually it's all the time I have to myself. So, and that's what I try to do. Even if I'm just going to the bathroom just to read my book. That's what I'm doing.
Okay, great. Tell us how, you know, new people go about developing a prayer life when they don't have any, you know, background or foundation. How did you develop the interest that you develop in prayer? Because you come many times on Thursday morning at 5 o'clock. The reason why you come at 5 is because you have to get work at what time?
At 7:30.
How many kids do you have to get ready?
Four
kids. Now, what do you do with them when you come to prayer?
Usually, we still have about maybe 45 minutes before I can actually drop them off at daycare. So we go to the donut shop and we sit and talk at the donut shop. That's what we do every Thursday morning.
But you have them here at church on Thursday morning?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, now, in terms of prayer, we pray from 5 to 6, one way or the other. What do you find to do? How do you go about it? Because that's a long time to try to figure out what you're going to say in prayer. What is after you in prayer? What assists you in prayer that helped to kind of get you moving in that direction?
Usually I don't know what I'm going to pray about until I come here and just start praying. I mean, it could just be just to have a good day or just the stress of my whole ordeal with DHS.
Now, do you have a prayer book? Here's a prayer book.
Yeah, I got a prayer book.
Prayer book. I think some of y'all look like this here.
Mm-hmm. I
actually
got that.
She got that, and I see her back there reading. Mm-hmm. We've been praying. And she can read her book and saying things to the Lord out of this book. Mm-hmm. Which ones do you find very helpful to you? Which one of those declarations? Here's the one that has a little different cover on it, same material.
The one I read the most is I cast my worries.
What's that?
Cast my worries.
Cast your cares?
Worries.
Your worries, okay.
My worries and my fears. I declare that I'm blessed. Read that one a lot.
You declare that you're blessed.
I read that a lot.
All of these are this one?
No, I read the book, but the ones I read the most are those two.
Okay.
Like I read those over and over.
Okay. Cast in your cares or your worries. And the other one is
I declare I'm blessed.
And
it's just 21 of those statements. It just says, I declare I'm blessed when I go out, I declare I'm blessed when I come in.
Freedom, 21 freedom. I think everybody started with 21 freedom truths pretty well.
Yeah.
That's very good.
That's a good one.
Okay. All right. I think that maybe we can get a little bit more insight as to what we can tell new people when they when we are drawn into dealing a relationship with them as to what direction they need to pursue. Brother Travis, give us some idea as to how you approach the fact that when you got saved, and I'm not sure whether you were feeling the Holy Spirit, and then you were doing a little waving. I'm not supposed to tell you. All right, everybody here, Brother Travis testimony. He's got his testimony on the track. It's public information. All right. Brother Travis, what did your girlfriend tell you when you got, when she got saved first, right?
The Paula got saved first.
And y'all were standing back, right?
Yeah, we were engaged, but you were
engaged.
Yeah, but we weren't in no hair.
You were in no hair.
Yeah, because we both, been married before, and we were just taking our time. Mm-hmm. But when she started coming here, things, changed for her. Instantly. She came home from church one day and she told me that she would share our bed with, but she wouldn't be intimate with me no more. But she just said, I'll cut you off. But, I didn't get upset, nothing like that, because I knew she had gave her life to Christ and became born again. And, and she was so happy. She was so different. And she was so new. Because that would never come out of her mouth before. So I knew it was something different, about her. And so I had to honor that, because I was in love with her, and I respected her, and I had to respect her decision, but that made me suspicious of what was going on at this church. After living with her for several months and just watching, I wasn't waiting to see her stumble, anything like that. I was just watching her continually grow in her faith and in the areas where she was, weak or had issues, that she was gaining strength, in those areas, and she did it all with conviction, with drive, and then she was still happy and stuff the whole time, still there. And, it was a different kind of joy in my life. So when she invited me, to come and stuff, which I was going through a whole lot of stuff, So when she invited me to come to church that day, that Sunday, everything that I've been going through, and she had no idea that I was going to give my life to Christ. But when I did, receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior, I became born again. And then it was a few minutes after that, Brother Donnell, started ministering to me. Took me and some other people back there. Mm-hmm. And he was, trying to get me to ask me if I wanted to receive the Holy Spirit. And, I didn't know exactly what he was talking about, but he was coaching me and telling me to, just begin to speak, but, without using words. Words are normal. Just let stuff come out of my mouth, but don't let it be English. Mm-hmm. And at first I struggled with that. But then I said a prayer you know, to God, because I, because from my damn life to Christ, I was already like this how the football, you know, and it lifted a lot of things up on me. Mm. So I said a prayer. I said, God, if you just remove everything from me. So I got one hang up. I can't just give up just yet. And that was the marijuana. And I said, but trust me, you know, you just bear with me. I promise you, you know, I give it up. And when I made that promise, then I started praying and it started coming out mumbling, you know. Well, I slowly began to speak in tongues. And when we come back out here, and I was doing much better than I thought. But when I did, you know, I just felt so much weight, you know, that was just lifted up, you know, all the depression, the anxiety, all of that stuff that I came in here with, the medication and stuff that I was taking. You know, from that day, I never took another pill for, you know, for depression or anxiety or so sleep medicine and none of that. And that was Easter Sunday. But by September, I bought a bag of weed and I was, something was just eating on me, you know, just weighing on me. So I rolled up a lot of cigarettes and I just started smoking a lot. And then I just put it out. You know, when I put it out, I had some left in the bag. And I said, God, thank you, you know, for waiting on me, you know, for allowing me to get this out of the way. And I prayed about it. And that day I never smoked, you know, never picked up another joint. And I never smoked again. You know, I was just able to cut it loose, you know, just like that. You know. And I never had a desire, you know, to do it again. It's been a little over 10 years.
But the desire, the Lord took that desire away from you. But there are things that you were doing that enabled that desire to be, you know.
Yeah, in the meantime, yeah.
Right.
Coming to church.
Yeah, coming to church. Being in prayer.
Being in prayer, and I think the biggest thing that really helped me in that area was that you made it available for me to come on Tuesday and Thursday morning. Mm-hmm. Because, I worked on Sunday, so I couldn't be here on Sunday. Mm-hmm. And it was those 5 a.m.s, you know, that really helped me get a stronghold on my faith. And began to pray and learn how to pray in those times. That's why I love them today. That really set my foundation, you know, for me to be where I am today. If it wasn't for those Tuesdays and Thursday mornings, I don't think I would have lasted very long. But I needed that time to grow without feeling left out or falling behind, like I was so far behind that I would, you know, be discouraged and not want to do it. But those times were so important to me. You know, it allowed me to read at my own pace and get an understanding, you know, Joel and God, which is the man I am today.
All right, well, that's good. Now, who has really seen the benefits of receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Your life really drastically changed after you received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Anybody?
I just know what big devil I was.
Who was that?
I
we're going to focus on the Holy Spirit. Friday evening, Sunday morning, and you can see what kind of breakthrough you can get. So we'll have to leave. I guess we can read through the scripture, right? But we thank God for this whole time.
New people, you know, they do come how they have lived. That's really a good example. Monday night, I had my prayer book open, and I had it open to a generational person. And then I had my Bible open to Psalms 27. You know, had it on the corner there. And after a while, the other day, come in, and she was having some issues. That has some issues. We still have some, you know, some families that said that they didn't have a real good holiday because of family abuse and stuff like that. You know, so God, you know, the Holy Spirit, like God knows in advance, and a lot of times, what a person's need, they'll set you up, you know, just for that purpose. You know, so my prayer was open right where it needed to be. When I read the generation curse, first we prayed for it. Sister Irene, you know, cut loose on it. And we prayed, you know, down here in the circle. Mm-hmm. And then after that, you know, I read the generation curse. Mm-hmm. And then I read Psalms 27, which was right what she needed. It was exactly what she did. Yeah. You know, it was just amazing. You know, that's another thing about Monday night. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why it's so important for me to make sure the doors are open, or somebody's here if I'm not here. Mm-hmm. We never know. Mm-hmm. You know, when someone will come to their door for me. Mm-hmm.
All right, excellent. Now, new people, you can use this manual. You have to talk to people, develop a relationship before you know what to do. You just don't haul off and just start doing stuff. You just try to locate them, just see where they are. If they're not located in this little book, this deals mainly with salvation and the Holy Spirit. That's the main thing that we are focusing on. I'll be going over portions of this with them, but that doesn't mean that you can't build a relationship with those that you feel that you want to connect with. And you want to make sure that they understand the basic things like this. Now, a lot of times people have difficulties. They have a lot of fears and a lot of reluctance or excuses and different things like this. But you can pretty well address just about any kind of problem the person is having from this book here. So this book here is really good. And you know, of course, we always use the meditation book. Help people on a daily basis with their meditation, help them to get established in prayer. These are things that everybody is going to have to have. And of course, we will move up to this book here, Salvation of the Holy Spirit, which is a lot of basic foundational teaching. But we don't worry too much about this. We just want to get them saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. And new people coming in now, I'm going to talk a lot about them initially getting involved in inviting their friends and relatives and trying to focus a lot on the importance of the ministry of reconciliation. So that's what we're going to do, because when they get saved with the Holy Spirit, we want them to just share that with as many people as they can.
Amen.
That's the reason we want them to have a unique, dynamic experience with the Lord, to the extent where they have no more desire to continue in the same lifestyle that they have been focusing on for years and years and years. All right, so everybody want to make sure that the new person will have this book here? They have this little book here. This is, everybody should have this in here. This is the Soul Winners Minute. We're going to start out with the new people, teaching them to win souls. That's the main reason why they're saved. They will get involved in that. A lot of their problems and habits and all of the things that the world has to offer will begin to kind of fade and begin to lose their appeal. Okay, everybody stand. I do want y'all to move these, meet these wonderful ladies here. And we all make them feel like they are part. And I tell you that Mr. Holland is probably going to call you on a consistent basis. And a lot of our sisters and brothers here, going to be calling me too. Amen. So we want everybody to meet them, get acquainted with them, and get to know them and see how you can help them sow into their lives. All right. Father, we thank you tonight for your love, your goodness, and all that you have done for us. We thank you, Lord, for beginning the good work within us. And you who have begun the good work will continue to perform. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody sing together. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. 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 Sister Mary, did you?